Well, you've come a long way since I saw you in 1971. I have to say, lots more lights.
And where was it when you saw Genesis?
Less hair. Less hair.
It was at school.
Yeah. And now they're playing to how many people in Rome, Phil?
Well, they said 500,000, but it was a free concert, so it's very difficult to... They came up with that figure, so we don't really know. We'll never know. No. There was people everywhere. I mean, it was people in the street were listening because it was loud. Yeah.
It was a free-for-all.
Yeah.
Yeah. And in fact, on that point, I need to ask you, because one of the questions that's come in is, why a free concert for the audience in Rome, but not a free concert for your fans back here?
Well, the Italians prefer not to pay. It is true. We used to have problems in the early days, in fact, because people used to kind of break into the arenas because they didn't really like, they wanted free music. Anyhow, it seemed the simplest thing to do, and it was a place that really took us to their hearts in very early days, and it was kind of nice to go back there after all this time and do something like that.
Yeah, and the atmosphere must have been absolutely incredible. 500,000
people. It was fantastic.
I mean,
I think for us, we played Rome so many times in the stadium or the arenas, the concrete buildings, and to actually be outside in the Circus Maximus, the chariot place, was just fantastic in that sort of setting and quite remote, yeah.
So you did that big tour after 15 years. Mm-hmm. It took a huge amount of organisation. One of the interesting things about the DVDs is you've got this documentary showing just how much goes into it, including a huge quest between you and the other drummer, Chester, to find the right kind of stool to whack your sticks on.
Yeah.
So obviously a lot of work goes into it. Is that it now?
Yeah, we found the stools, it's all over.
In terms of touring, is that...
I don't think any of us really thought we'd be here talking about this now, so... But I think it probably is, as much as one can tell anything, I mean, I think we've all got families of different ages. I've got two little boys and I want to stay at home and be with them and bring them up. And touring takes me away from home, so I'm knocking that particular thing on the head.
So that's it then? No more touring?
No more touring. As tours, yeah, probably, yeah. That's 99.9%. That's the...
When he says that,
not music,
that doesn't mean touring. No more lives, no more gigs, or does he? I don't know. What do you mean?
I think that, it just means no more kind of like relentless touring, okay. I think is what it means, really.
That's right.
The odd bit, special thing.
I mean, it's just... performing, I do reserve the right to sort of say, I fancy doing that, how many gigs is it? There's four shows, five shows. Oh, we could do that.
Good. I think sort of hordes of Genesis fans are now breathing again after that answer, so that's good.
Yeah, but,
And what about...
He giveth in one hand, he taketh in the other,
Yeah. How clear are we on that now?
I'm not clear.
Tracy from Burnley says, they saw you in Manchester, absolutely fantastic. It's left them questioning whether you could do it all again, because it obviously takes, an enormous amount of effort and organisation, takes a lot out of you and your families. She specifically wants to know, there is a rumour being discussed on the official fan club forum that there is going to be a tour in 2010 which could involve Peter Gabriel. Do you get rumours like that all the time, or is there some substance in that this time round?
Well, she's obviously better informed than we are. There's been talk about doing something with Peter for years. We've talked about the last 4 or 5 years, we've talked about it. It's still a possibility, It'd been quite nice to revisit the early period of the group, because it's sort of, I think it's looked on with more affection now, perhaps, than it was at the time in many ways. And it'd be quite nice to do that. We had this big album, The Lamb Last Night on Broadway, a big double concept album, which would be quite fun to try and restage properly now. But I think we don't know the answer to it. If Peter suddenly said he wanted to do it, then we probably would consider it, I think.
Yeah.
All the ways of getting in touch, Peter, could be on the
on screen now.
If you want to contact us about that.
Richard says in Dunblane, how do you go about recreating those particular sounds, especially the vintage keyboard sounds, on some of the early tracks? Do you still have some of the old instruments?
You're asking me again. It's a very boring question.
You play double-necked guitar. You got a new one for the tour, didn't you?
Yeah, the old one has sort of died a death, actually.
I wanted to ask you, we had a guitar in last week called The Beast, which has 6 necks and 40 strings. And it's a store in Charing Cross Road here in London. So
who plays it?
Nobody does, because nobody's quite got enough arms. But I was watching you last night thinking, well, actually, you might be able to have a go.
I think two's hard enough, actually. Yeah. 6 is a bit beyond me.
Pretty heavy.
It is.
Mm. Pretty heavy.
You have to have it on the floor.
But anyway, the answer to the question, Tony.
What's the question?
Vintage keyboard sound.
Actually, I just used modern keyboards to recreate the old sounds, actually, because the old keyboards were so difficult to kind of tame. They had their own little ways. Whereas the modern stuff, you can get the same sounds, or similar sounds, or better sounds even, in a much simpler manner. So that's what I did.
I can't believe we're talking about it as a vintage time. But 20 years ago, we can have a look at you back in the 80s. Let's have a quick squiz.
It's as if it was yesterday.
Yeah, nothing's changed.
Nothing's changed at all, only the shirt. Mr. Vickery, would you ask the band, please, if they would not rule out the possibility of them making a new album together at some stage in the future?
Deafening silence.
That's one for you, Phil.
I think we all agree that there was a chemistry, there is a chemistry between the three of us. You know, we still... And unlike some bands that split up that don't like each other, you know, we actually are almost friends first. And we do, you know, there's lots of evidence of the fact the three of us just can get into a room and do something that is quite extraordinary and outside anything we can do on our own. So it would be nice to think that we could exploit that some more, you know, and just sit down. And I don't know what happens to it after we've written it, that's the thing, you know, because a new Genesis album means the, you know, you light the touch paper for the rest of the stuff that goes on, and which I don't really want to do.
Including the T-O-U-R word.
You know, and but in terms of us sitting down and writing music that maybe no one will ever hear apart from the fact of us, apart from us, it's quite possible, but that doesn't help the person.
He's so enigmatic, isn't he? He sort of teases you with
that. Likes to play hard to get.
Yes. Well, I could just sit and say no to everything if you want. Yeah,
no, it's a very short interview if you did.
Struan asked a question which has been playing on our minds. Towards the end of last year, we saw a gorilla warming up at a set of drums. And then launch into, you know, one of the most famous pieces of drum music we've heard. It's coming in the air tonight, or in the air tonight. It was a chocolate advert. What did you make of it?
Well, I was asked if I minded them doing it. You know, I kind of had to ask permission. And I said, what are they going to do? And they said, they're going to have a gorilla playing the drums. I said, you make that work, it's fine with me, you know. And actually, the advert was on before I'd seen it. But I thought it was fantastic. You know, I mean, it's great. He's got the eyes. And,
you didn't get hot inside that suit when he was playing.
It wasn't me, but it's actually his.
Played quite well though, didn't he?
Yeah, he plays better than me.
Yeah. And what did you think, you two, when you saw that?
It's great. He's just much better looking drummer, I think. No, it was.
It was. All that
no, it's such a sort of. It was a great ad, just because it's what it's the sense of the song is. Once you've heard it once, you're just waiting for that drum fill, aren't you? And that's sort of what it's all about. It works very, very well, I think. We're looking for a follow up. I think we should do a follow up.
Well,
yeah. I mean, but
perhaps one of our songs.
It spawned a lot of other parodies of it. There was a Wonder Bra. Version of it, which was quite exciting.
There's lots of
things on YouTube.
Excellent. So in one sense, the music just lives on, whether you like it or not. So we're looking forward to the new album, the new tour, and the reunion within the next 12 months, right?
Whatever you say.
Lovely to see you all.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Really great to have you on the Sofa this morning. Thanks very much indeed.
We're going to run because we're going to do a gig in Eton.
Have you?
Yes. Right. I'll be there. 90
quid's your fee. Do you remember?
Right, yeah.
Amy McDonald.